Hello everyone, welcome you all. Let's start our discussion and solve question paper of CUCET 2018. As you know, here we will solve B part only. So let's start from question number 26. So question number 26. Apparent length of a meter rod moving parallel to its length with velocity 0.6c will be. So a meter rod is moving parallel to its length with speed 0.6c. We have to find the contracted length. As we know, when an object moves parallel to its length, its length contracts or decreases, and the length is given by L equals to L naught square root under 1 minus b square by c square, where L naught is the rest length. And rest length here is 1 meter. And you should remember, the length contracts only when the object moves parallel to its length. And when if the rod moves perpendicular to its length, if let be some 0.6c. Now in this case, the object is moving perpendicular to its length. So in this case, the length will be same as rest length. There will be no contraction in length. Only when the length changes, when the object has a speed or velocity component parallel to its length. So in this case, let the object moves at an angle theta to its length, then in this case the velocity will be having two component. One is perpendicular component, another is parallel component. So change in length or contracted length L is given by L naught into square root under 1 minus V parallel square by C square, or V parallel is L naught square root under 1 minus V square cos square theta by C square. Here in this case theta is 0, so cos 0 1. So L equals to L naught square root under 1 minus V square by C square. Okay, so now using the value of speed, even calculate the length. So L naught is 1 meter square root under 1 minus 0.6 square. C square sin square will cancel out. So it is 1 meter square root under 1 minus 0.36, or 1 meter, it is 0.64, that is equals to 1 meter into 0.8 or 0.8 meter. So your correct option is option A. Question number 27. X-ray of wavelength 10 picometer are scattered from a target. The wavelength of X-ray scattered through angle 45 degree will be. So here we have a X-ray of wavelength 10 picometer. Picometer means, as we know, nanometer equals to 10 to the power minus 9 meter, Armstrong is 10 to the power minus 10 meter, picometer equals to 10 to the power minus 12 meter, and femto is 10 to the power minus 15 meter, or 1 Fermi. So this X-ray of wavelength 10 picometer is scattered from a target at an angle 45 degree. And from Compton scattering, we know that the Compton shift, that is lambda dash minus lambda equals to h by m naught c 1 minus cos phi. And this Compton shift is independent of the wavelength of the incident radiation and independent of the nature of the target material. But it depends on the angle of scattering. And here h by m naught c is the Compton wavelength, and its value is 0.0242 Armstrong or 0.00242 nanometer. So from here we can write lambda dash, that is the wavelength of the scattered X-ray, equals to lambda plus 0.00242 nanometer into 1 minus cos phi. So phi is given, that is 45 degree, and we know cos 45 is 1 by root 2. So 1 minus 1 by root 2. 1 माइनस 1 बाई रूट 2 इट विल बी 1 माइनस, देखो 1 बाई रूट 2 कैसे कैलकुलेट करेंगे कि रूट 2 न्यूमिरेटर और डिनोमिनेटर पे रूट 2 मल्टीप्लाई कर दो, तो ये हो जाएगा रूट 2 बाई 2, सो रूट 2 इज 1.414 बाई 2, इट विल बी 0.707, सो 1 माइनस 0.707 दैट विल बी इक्वल्स टू 0.293, ओके, सो 1 माइनस कॉस फाई इज 0.293, सो लैम्बडा डैश इक्वल्स टू लैम्बडा, लैम्बडा इज 10 पिकोमीटर प्लस इट इज इन नैनोमीटर, सो कन्वर्ट इट इनटू पिकोमीटर आल्सो, सो इट विल बी 2.42 पिकोमीटर इनटू 0.293. नाउ दिस इज 10 पिकोमीटर प्लस 0.709 पिकोमीटर व्हिच इज इक्वल्स टू 10.709 पिकोमीटर, सो योर करेक्ट ऑप्शन इज ऑप्शन ए. क्वेश्चन नंबर 28, ए पॉजिट्रोनियम एटम इज अ सिस्टम दैट कंसिस्ट ऑफ ए पॉजिट्रॉन एंड एन इलेक्ट्रॉन दैट ऑर्बिट ईच अदर, द वेवलेंथ ऑफ स्पेक्ट्रल लाइंस ऑफ द पॉजिट्रोनियम विल बी. Here we have to find the wavelength of the spectral lines of positronium comparing to the hydrogen spectral lines. So from Bohr's atomic model, we have the wavelength of the hydrogen atom spectral lines is given by this mathematical expression, where R infinity is the Rydberg constant, which is given by me e to the power 4 by 8 hqc epsilon naught square, and its value is 1.097 into 10 to the power 7 meter inverse. Pay attention, its unit is meter inverse, because if you see that equation, z square unit less, n square dimension less, unit less, lambda is has unit of length, so it is 1 by lambda, so its dimension should be 1 by length. Now if you see the expression of R infinite, here it is mass of electron. And while calculating this mathematical expression, we took the concept of reduced mass. Reduced mass. So here it is R infinity, reduced mass e to the power 4 8 hqc epsilon naught square. And here reduced mass is me. And we define reduced mass as mass of nucleus times mass of electron by mass of nucleus plus mass of electron. And as we assume mass of nucleus is very very high in comparison to electron, we can eliminate mass of electron comparing to nucleus, so it will be mass of electron only. And for approximation calculation, you should remember mass of proton is taken as 1836 time of mass of electrons, okay. Here R infinity is written because in hydrogen atom we take mass of nucleus to be infinite in comparing to the mass of electrons, so it is written as R infinity. Now we can write this to be Rs, that is mu e to the power 4 8 hqc epsilon naught square. So Rh proportional to mu h, reduced mass for hydrogen atom. And from this formula we can write that wavelength for hydrogen spectral line is proportional to r by 1 by Rh. In the similar way for positronium atom we can write lambda p proportional to 1 by Rp, and Rp will be proportional to reduced mass for positronium atom. So let us calculate the reduced mass for positronium atom. So that will be formula m1 m2 by m1 plus m2. m2 is generally m2 is for electron, and m1 we take for nucleus. So here in nucleus there is a positronium, positron. So and positron has mass equals to the electron. So me times me by 2m, so it is equals to me by 2. Now we have mu h equals to me and mu p equals to me by 2. That is mu p equals to mu h by 2. So now lambda h by lambda p equals to rp by rh. From here, rp by rh equals to mu p by mu h, and from here mu p by mu h equals to half. Okay, so mu h by mu p equals to half, or from here lambda p equals to 2 times of lambda h. So wavelength of spectral lines of the positronium will be twice the hydrogen spectral lines. So your correct option is option B. Question number 29. A particle limited to the x-axis has a wave function psi equal to ax between x equals to 0 and x equal to 1, and psi equals to 0 elsewhere. The expectation value of particle's position. So a one-dimensional wave function psi equal to ax is given. We have to find the expectation value of position operator. And we know for any operator, the expectation value is given by psi a cap psi by psi inner product of psi. And for normalized wave function, we know this inner product will be equals to 1. So here expectation value of position operator equals to psi x psi, or which is equals to 0 to 1. This is complex conjugate of psi, but as it is a real wave function, so it will be ax then x then ax dx. Now it is equals to a square x cube 0 to 1 dx. So a square x to the power 4 by 4 from 0 to 1. So it is equals to a square by 4. So your correct option is option A. Question number 30. Nuclear magneton is given by. So before describing nuclear magneton, let us first define Bohr magneton. Bohr magneton mu b is given by E h cot by 2 m e, and its value is 9.274 into 10 to the power minus 24 joule by tesla. Or if you express this value in terms of electron volt, then you can convert it by dividing 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19. That will be equals to 5.796 into 10 to the power minus 5 electron volt per tesla. So magnetic moment associated with electrons orbiting around the nucleus is given by in terms of Bohr magneton. And in nuclear physics, magnetic moment associated with the spin of protons or neutrons are expressed in terms of nuclear magneton, and it is given by E h cot by 2 times mass of proton. H cot is the reduced Planck constant. H cot equals to h by 2 pi. This is the reduced Planck constant, and its value is 1.054 into 10 to the power minus 34 joule second. And nuclear magneton value is 5.05 into 10 to the power minus 27 joule by tesla. Similarly, you can express it in terms in unit of electron volt by tesla. That is equals to 3.15 into 10 to the power minus 18 electron volt by tesla. You should remember, 1 electron volt equals to 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 joule. So you can convert it in easily. Okay, so magnetic moment of proton is given by 2.79 nuclear magneton. Magnetic moment of neutron is given by minus 1.91 nuclear magneton. And magnetic moment of electron, which is given in terms of Bohr magneton, is given by minus 1.0116 Bohr magneton. क्वेश्चन नंबर 31, रेडियस ऑफ ए न्यूक्लियस डिपेंड्स ऑन इट्स मास नंबर ए एंड इट इज प्रोपोर्शनल टू. वी हैव रेडियस आर इक्वल्स टू आर नॉट ए टू द पावर 1/3. सो रेडियस आर इज प्रोपोर्शनल टू इट्स मास नंबर एच ए टू द पावर 1/3. क्वेश्चन नंबर 32, पेरिटी इज नॉट कंजर्व्ड इन, पेरिटी इज नॉट कंजर्व्ड इन बीटा डीके. एंड यू शुड रिमेंबर दैट पेरिटी इज नॉट कंजर्व्ड इन वीक इंटरेक्शंस. क्वेश्चन नंबर 33, द हाफ लाइफ ऑफ गोल्ड न्यूक्लियस इज 2.7 डेज, द प्रोबेबिलिटी दैट गोल्ड न्यूक्लियस विल डीके इन 1 सेकेंड. Half life of gold nucleus is 2.7 days. So you have to find the probability of decay in 1 second. So probability that it will decay in 2.7 days will be half. So probability that it will decay in 1 day will be 1/2 into 2.70. Similarly, probability that it will decay in 1 second, that will be 1/2 into 2.70 into 3600 second into 24, because 1 day equals to 24 hour, or this is equals to 24 into 3600 second, and this probability equals to 2.14 into 10 to the power minus 6. So this is the probability that any gold nucleus will decay in 1 second. Question number 34. Half-life of a radioactive isotope is 4 into 10 to the power 8 years. If there are 10 to the power 3 radioactive nuclei in a sample today, the number of such nuclei in this sample 4 into 10 to the power 9 years ago. So half-life of a radioactive isotope is given. In today, it has 10 to the power 3 radioactive nuclei. So you have to be careful here. This is N, and you have to calculate the initial amount, that is 4 into 10 to the power 9 years ago. We have N equals to N naught half to the power t by t half. Okay, so we have n and we have to find this n naught. So n naught equals to n times 2 to the power t by t half. T is the total time and t half is the half life. So n is 10 to the power 3. Now 2 to the power t, 4 into 10 to the power 9 by 4 into 10 to the power 8, so it is 10, and 2 to the power 10 is 1024 into 10 to the power 3. So this is the initial amount of that radioactive isotope. So your correct option is option D. Question number 35. Raleigh-Jeans law is deduced from the Planck's radiation formula under the condition of. So we have Owen's energy distribution formula as this, and this is the Raleigh-Jeans formula, and this mathematical expression is the Planck's energy distribution. So now let us look at the behavior of Planck's distribution in the limits of low frequency. Low frequency means h nu, h much less than kT, or at high temperature. So this exponential h nu by kT will be equals to 1 plus h nu by kT in the limit of low frequency, because we have exponential x equals to 1 plus x plus x square by 2 factorial plus x cube by 3 factorial plus dot dot dot. So for very small value of x, it will be approximated to 1 plus x, that is 1 plus h nu by kT here. So now when we will use this approximation value here, 1 and 1 will be cancelled out. So there will be h nu by kT. So again h nu will be cancelled out, and then the energy density distribution will be equals to 8 pi nu square by c cube, that is h nu by kt. So h nu will be cancelled out, so it will be equal to 8 pi nu square by c cube kt, which is the Rayleigh-Jean's energy distribution formula. So we can say that this Planck energy distribution reduces to Rayleigh-Jean's formula at low frequency, high temperature. Low frequency means large wavelength and high temperature. Similarly, you can see in the limit of high frequency, the Planck's energy distribution yields Wien's rule. So high frequency means low wavelength, and in this limit, Planck's distribution yields Wien's law. So here you can see that the Planck's energy distribution fit to the various experimental radiation distribution at all frequency range. And the Wien's law formula fits at high frequency and it fails at low frequency. Similarly, the Rayleigh-Jean's law follows the experimental data at low frequency and diverges for high values of frequency. Question number 36. The foreign radioactive decay series begins with thorium and ends at lead. Number of alpha and beta particles emitted in the chain reaction are respectively. So here we have to find the number of alpha particle and beta particles emitted in this series. And we know when an alpha particle is emitted from a nucleus, its charge decreases by 2 units and mass number decreases by 4 units. And when a beta particle emitted from a nucleus, its charge increases by 1 unit and mass number remains same. So here we can see in this series, the mass number changes by 24 unit and charge changes by 8 unit. So for this mass number change, 24 unit, we need 6 alpha particles. And if 6 alpha particles are involved, then there will be change in the charge unit will be 12 unit. But here we can see there is only change in charge is 8 unit. So to compensate this, we have to increase the charge to 4 unit. So 4 beta particles have to emit from the in the series to compensate this charge. So we need 6 alpha particles and 4 beta particles. So your correct option is option D. Question number 37. In photoelectric effect, the kinetic energy of emitted electrons depend on. From Einstein's photoelectric equation, we have kinetic energy of emitted electrons equals to h nu minus w naught. W naught is the work function of the metal. And here h is the Planck constant and nu is the frequency of the incident radiation. So the kinetic energy of the emitted radiation depends on the frequency of the incident radiation. So your correct option is option D. Question number 38. Displacement current appears because of. We have to define the displacement current. So if you see the Maxwell's fourth equation, that is curl B equals to mu naught J plus mu naught epsilon naught del E by del T. Here J is the current density and this epsilon naught del E by del T is the displacement current density. That is JD equals to epsilon naught del E by del T. So from here we can define current H surface integral of JD. And we know surface integral of electric field gives us the electric flux. So displacement current from here is epsilon naught del phi E by del T. Phi is the electric flux. So this is the expression of displacement current. So we can say the displacement current is due to the time varying electric field. So your correct option is option A. Question number 39.
A chalk coil of resistance 5 ohm and inductance of 0.6 Henry is in series with a capacitance of 10 microfarad. If a voltage of 200 volt is applied and the frequency is adjusted to resonance, the current in the circuit will be.
So a series RLC circuit is given and value of R, C and L are given. We have to define here the current flowing in this circuit. And we have I equals to V by Z. Z is the impedance of this series RL circuit and it is given by square root under R square plus XL minus XC square. XL equals to omega L and XC equals to 1 by omega C. But according to question, the frequency is adjusted to resonance. And we know in series resonance condition, XL equals to XC. So here impedance will be R. So current I equals to V by R. So voltage here 200 volt. Resistance is 5 ohm. So it is 40 ampere. So your correct option is option A. Question number 40. For air glass interface, the refraction and transmission coefficient respectively for an electromagnetic wave falling normally on the interface edge. So in this air glass interface, glass medium has a refractive index of 1.5 and we have reflection coefficients equals to n2 minus n1 square divided by n1 plus n2 square and transmission coefficient is 4n1 n2 by n1 plus n2 square. So using the value of n1 n2 you can easily calculate value of R and T. So it is 1.5 minus 1 whole square by 1.5 plus 1 square which is equals to 1 by 5 whole square, that is equals to 0.04. Now for transmission coefficient it is 4 into 1 into 1.5 divided by 1.5 plus 1 square which is equals to 0.96. So your correct option is option C. In this video we have completed 15 questions. So let's stop here and we will continue in the next video. Thanks for watching and see you in the next one.